Open with me in your Bibles to the book of Hebrews chapter 2. Hebrews chapter 2. And the Lord will help us tonight to understand some spiritual truths. Some spiritual truths. Hebrews chapter 2. We're going to be looking at from verse, I will read a couple of verses. We're going to look at verse 10. We're going to start from verse 10. Amen. And we'll be picking out some couple of truths here. We're going to also marry that scripture to other scriptures, both in the Old Testament and the New Testament as well. The best way to interpret scripture is with scripture. Amen. The best way to interpret scripture is with scripture. And the purpose of teaching the gospel, the purpose of preaching the gospel is to point people to Jesus. Not to ourselves. Amen? Amen? The purpose of preaching, the purpose that we teach, the purpose that we come together is to bring glory to Him, is to edify the body of Christ, not to speak of ourselves, but to speak of Him. Amen? Amen? That is why in this assignment, in God movement, by the help of the Holy Spirit, we endeavor to point people to Christ in word and in deed. So look at that. Hebrews chapter 2, I read from verse 10. In bringing many souls to glory, it was fitting that God, for whom and through whom everything exists, should make the author of their salvation perfect through suffering. Underline that word, through suffering. The author of their salvation perfect through suffering. Verse 11. But the one who makes men holy and those who are made holy are of the same family. So Jesus is not ashamed to call them brothers. He's not ashamed to call you friend. Some of you who know, those of you that know our theme this month, godly relationships. This is powerful. Jesus, the author of our salvation, made perfect through suffering, makes us holy, makes us one family. And he's not ashamed to say that we are brothers. He's not ashamed to say that we are brethren. Hallelujah. Amen. I want you to go to verse 14. Since the children have flesh and blood, he too shared in their humanity, so that by his death, look at that, he shared in our humanity because we are flesh and blood, so that by his death he might destroy him who holds the power of death. That is the devil. Yeah. Verse 15. And free those who all their lives were held in slavery by fear and death. If you go to 1 John chapter 3 verse 8, he's saying the same thing there. For this purpose the Son of Man was made manifest, that he might destroy the works of the devil. Jesus had to experience what it means to be flesh and blood, shared in our humanity, partook in the sufferings that any of you can go through or would go through or has ever been through. Jesus went through all of that, understood all of that pain. And after having gone through it, he's not ashamed. After having gone through it and obtained eternal salvation, victory forever, freedom forever for us, he's not ashamed to say, you are my brother, you are my sister, you are one family with me, you are a friend. Hallelujah. Amen. The theme, as you know, for this month is godly relationships. And tonight, I am introducing you to your best friend. Somebody say, my best friend.
My best friend.
My best friend.
My best friend.
Your best friend is Jesus. Somebody say, my best friend is Jesus.
My best friend is Jesus.
That is who I have come to introduce to you tonight. Bow down your heads. Father, I pray that you speak spiritual truths tonight. Explain and give cause for the meaning of your word. Give sense to it, Father. Bring victory to someone's life through your power, the power of your word, in Jesus Christ's name.
Amen.
Amen. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
So, as we have read tonight from that passage of scripture, we see that Jesus is not ashamed to call us what?
Brethren.
To call us brothers. So, he is with us. He understands our pain. Amen. He understands our pain. He understands everything. And what is the Lord leading us to understand tonight? The Lord is leading us to understand tonight that there is a relationship that matters. There is a relationship that what matters. Not everything matters. Amen.
Amen.
But relationships matter. A relationship can determine your success in life. A relationship can determine how far you go in life. A relationship can determine whether you have somebody to stand with you during your difficult moments. A relationship will determine your joy. Hallelujah.
Amen.
A relationship can determine your ruin. It can determine poverty. It can determine wealth. It can determine riches. Hallelujah.
Amen.
But what we have just read has made us understand that this Jesus, the Son of God, who partook, who gave of himself, gave up everything that is his glory, and became like us, so that we might obtain the same blessings that he himself carries. Hallelujah.
Amen.
That Jesus, this Jesus that I am talking about, is your best friend. He is the best friend that sticks closer than a brother. Amen. If you go to Proverbs chapter 18, go with me there quickly. I'll be showing you some scriptures. Proverbs chapter 18. Proverbs chapter 18. Look at verse 24. It says, Proverbs chapter 18, verse 24. Verse 24. It says, a man of many companions may come to ruin, but there is a friend who sticks closer than a brother. Hallelujah.
Amen.
That scripture is telling us of Jesus. But I want to also make you understand something. That scripture, while it is telling us of Jesus, also is telling us of the Jesus in people. Hallelujah.
Amen.
There is somebody you can encounter, God will make you encounter in your life, that truly represents this Jesus. And this person can be also that close friend that you need. Can be a destiny helper. Are you following me tonight?
Yes,
there is Jesus in people. And when that Jesus comes to the fore in people, it can be a blessing to you. Because oftentimes when God is going to bless you, he's going to use human beings. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
This scripture is giving us a clear picture of a friend that will never desert you, no matter what you go through in life. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
And that person is Jesus. But that Jesus also is in us. Hallelujah. But I want to, as we travel, because I will not finish all this subject tonight. I'm just making an introduction. But this foundation is very important for you. Hallelujah. We're going to be seeing many subjects that has to do with relationships, divine relationships, godly relationships. And it is deep and it is rich. You shouldn't miss any of it. But this is the foundation. Jesus had to take flesh and blood. This is a reality. Hallelujah. And I want to make you understand that reality very strongly using the person of Job tonight. Amen. I want to use Job as a character to make you really see the picture of what this Jesus did for us. Praise the Lord. Job, many scholars believe, lived around the time of Abraham, or they think he lived around the time of Abraham. Also, we believe that his story may have been written later after that, but that is the oldest book that was written in the Bible. Praise the Lord. But this Job, in the book of Job, we go to the book of Job, it has a prologue and an epilogue. The prologue being the beginning of the story. Hallelujah. And how it all ended. Hallelujah. And we see in the book of Job, if you go with me to the book of Job, we may not have to read it. I will just paraphrase something for you there. Amen. I will paraphrase some of the scriptures for you, some of what the story entails, what it says. And then, by the help of the Holy Spirit, continue with the message. If you look at the book of Job chapter 1 from verse 6 to 22, Job chapter 1 from verse 6 to 22, we see that there was an event that happened here. Job, hallelujah, praise the Lord. Please, I want you to help us with, is it marvelous? With the noise there, praise the Lord. Amen. So, there was an event that happened here. The Bible says that the children of God, the angels, the children of God came together and Satan came among them. Amen. So it means that is why when we're talking of relationship, it's a very deep subject. Nothing is ever as it first appears. Even in the church, the Bible says that Satan also presents himself as an angel of light. It means that even in the place where saints gather, where children of God gather, not everybody is what you think they are. Praise the Lord.
Satan came among where the children of God gathered because of one man. Some of you are encountering situations in your life. You don't know it is because you are so special. Hallelujah. The devil will not fight something that is insignificant. The devil will not fight something that has no value. They gathered here. The children of God came together. But Satan came among them. And God asked the question, have you considered my servant Job? Praise the Lord. Have you considered my servant Job? And Satan said, oh, you blessed him, you've protected him, you've put a hedge around him. Why would he curse God? Why would he do something against you? It's going well for him. God said, well, I give you permission, but don't harm the man. It tells us that story carries a lot of truth. Let me explain some points from there. It tells you that there is a conversation going on between God and the devil. There is always something going on. There is a conversation. God and the devil are in a battle. Hallelujah. But I want you to know that in that battle, Satan is still under the authority and power of God. Because if you look at it right there, it was with God's permission he was even able to go and do whatever he could do to Job. And God also gave him the limits to which he could go. That is why the Bible says that there is no temptation that is yet as yet overtaking you. God will not give you something that you are not able to bear. Hallelujah. Are you following me? Are you getting the spiritual truth? What I am telling you tonight is that anything that you are going through tonight is a stepping stone to your testimony. Because God in that situation is going to prove himself in your life. Are you following me? This happened for Job. There was a battle. There is always something going on. There is a conversation between God and the devil. But in it, the devil is subject to the authority of God. So if God said that there is nothing that will come against you that can overpower you, that you cannot bear, God means it. What God is telling you is that he will not allow Satan to go beyond what he could, what he would allow. Are you listening to me? The purpose, you see, there are things we cannot understand that God does, but God does it anyway. How do we know God does what he does? Because he's a just God. But he deals with us in his grace. It means God is not giving you sometimes the things you deserve. He is giving you what he wants to give you out of his mercy, out of his grace. Hallelujah. Are you hearing what I'm saying? So you can see that even right here in this story, why Satan came and the devil, they are not omnipresent. They are not present every day. That is why you see sometimes things are going well for you. At other times, suddenly the demons show up. Things suddenly seem not to be going very well. Because they're not omnipresent. Only God is omnipresent. So when things happen, don't just go off the hook and say, I will not serve God. Don't just go off the hook and say, I'm going to give up on God. Don't just go off the hook and say, I'm not going to do the things I used to do to bring glory to God. See that in that situation, there is a divine message. In every affliction, there is a divine mercy. God uses situations and circumstances to prove himself every time in your life. If you would just hold up to him. And we see that Job did just that. Job went through a period of very powerful, strong suffering. He went through a lot of pain because, of course, God gave Satan liberty to go and afflict him. And Satan took almost everything. In fact, Satan took everything he had. Praise the Lord. And if you go further, you will see that Job even had friends. I'm paraphrasing tonight. If you look at from verse 11 to 13, it gave us the introduction to his three friends. Hallelujah. It first gave us the introduction to his three friends. That is Eliphaz, the Temanite, Bildad, the Shuhite, and Zophar, the Naamathite. We have friends. Not just like some of you listening to me right now. You have friends. Hallelujah. All of these friends represented something to Job. Their conversations was, at the end, if you go to the epilogue, you see how God defined what they did or their conversations with Job. Praise the Lord. But they showed up. At least they showed up. Praise the Lord. When they saw that Job was going through suffering, they showed up. They came. I want to let you know, many people will show up in your life, some with a good motive, with the right intent, and many others without the right intent. So you must be careful to design who is God's given partner for me in this situation. Hallelujah. Are you listening to me? There is a message, like I said, in every circumstance. So when people come around you, it is often either to be a blessing or to be a problem. Are you hearing what I'm saying? When God is going to bless you, he will put someone in your life. And the same way, if you're going to have problems, if you're going to have setbacks, is also going to come often through people. The Bible says that it is a man's enemy. A man's enemies are members of his own household. It is often people that you have allowed access into your life that know you too well, that often have the capacity to do something evil.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
That is why you have to design relationships. But we are going somewhere tonight. So I'm using Job now as a picture of Jesus. Job is a type of Christ. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Job is a type of Christ. You can see, for example, what he said in Job chapter 19. Go to the book of Job chapter 19. You can see Jesus represented there. In Job chapter 19, let us look at verse 25 to 27. This is speaking of Jesus. Hallelujah. We started by saying that Jesus Christ became flesh and blood so that he can experience us. And then also, after his death and resurrection, give us the victory over that pain that he himself has experienced. So that we too will no longer experience those pains. But Job was a picture of that before it even ever happened. Amen. So both the suffering of Job and the restoration of Job is a picture of the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Are you following me tonight?
Yes, sir.
For example, look at the resurrection here. This is in Job chapter 19 from verse 25 to 27. I know that my Redeemer lives and that in the end he will stand upon the earth. And after my skin has been destroyed, yet in my flesh I will see God. I myself will see him with my own eyes. I and not another. How my heart yearns within me. Did that happen for Jesus or not?
Yes.
That happened for Jesus. He died and he rose again and he rose bodily. With a glorified body. Remember that he told them, give me fish so that he will eat, to prove to them that he is, you know, who he is. He even came to them through a door to show you with the power of a glorified body. Praise the Lord. And that is our portion in the resurrection. Hallelujah.
Amen.
What God is saying to us, from what I just told you, a little bit analogy of that, what God is saying to us is, no matter what you are going through, no matter what you have been through, no matter the circumstance, it doesn't matter, this part of eternity, God still has everything under control.
Amen.
God has everything under control in your life.
Amen.
What I am saying is that look at Job's story. With everything that the devil put on him, with everything that his friends that came around him did, it doesn't matter what it was, it doesn't matter the mockery, it doesn't matter the condescending statements, it doesn't matter the questioning, it doesn't matter even the advice that you were given. It doesn't matter. At the end of the day, what matters is what God is saying. God, in all of that process, in all of that circumstance, in all of that situation, has everything under control. What is the thing that he has under control? That the end of a thing is better than the beginning. Somebody say hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
That the end, the way you will end up, is a guaranteed it will be a success. Because he has it under control. Are you still holding on to God? Because look at Job. After everything he went through, look at what the Bible said. Many people have given up. Many people give up. If you listen to this message tonight, it's a time to wake up. Hallelujah. I said, if you're listening to this message tonight, it's a time to say, whoa, God is a God of restoration. He still got your back. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Are you hearing me tonight?
Yes.
I said, he still has you. This message is timely, that God is saying he has it under control. He will not let you go through something you cannot endure. That he has it under control. When Satan is buffeting, God is in the circumstance with you right there. Because look at Job. Don't give up. Don't curse God. Don't do something. Don't say, I will not do it and I will not serve God anymore. Because many people have given up before their breakthrough came. Your breakthrough is often closer. When it is closer, it's often when you go through the strongest and most difficult times. Do you know that women, before they give birth, they go through a lot of pain? Some of you, all of you know that it's proof of life. Hallelujah. But do you also know that sometimes even the sexes they give birth to determines the level of struggle sometimes they go through? Mamas, I'm sure you know what I'm talking about. It is true. It is true. Sometimes you see people come and tell you, oh, but before I had this person, this is what happened. Before I had this person. Every birth has something significant to it. Because you know why? You are special and God took time to make you. There is a destiny to every birth. That is why the church is against abortion. Hallelujah. Every person that God made has something to offer this life. God did not bring you to this earth not to give something. It is your choice if you do or not. But every birth has something significant to it. Hallelujah. Job, look at it. He never gave up. Look at it. This is still the beginning of the book. Look at verse 22. Look at verse 22. Let's start from verse 20. At this, after the Job lost everything, after Satan attacked every physical goods that he had, praise the Lord. After Satan came at him with everything that he had, look at what happened. Job said, at this, Job got up and tore his robe and shaved his head. Then he fell to the ground in worship and said, naked I came from my mother's womb, and naked I will depart. The Lord gave and the Lord has taken away. May the name of the Lord be praised. In all this, Job did not sin by charging God with wrongdoing. Job did not give up on God. Did Jesus give up on God? How many of you know that in a picture of Job, Job speaking of Jesus, I'm talking of Job like Jesus, amen? Job as a type of Christ. Job as a picture of Jesus. Look at this. Jesus went to the Garden of Gethsemane. Did he not pray and say, Father, let not my will but yours be done? The Bible says he prayed and his sweat was like agony. It was like blood. Hallelujah. He was in deep agony and his sweat was like what? Drops of blood. He was in deep agony. He was suffering. He was beaten. They mocked him. Soldiers mocked him. It is a replica. It's a picture exactly of what Job went through. Did he give up on God? Did Jesus give up on God? Job did not give up on God. Do you know that when I was teaching on anointed and appointed, the message anointed and appointed, and I recommend you to go and watch those messages. I was telling you that everything that Jesus represented while he was on earth, now he is living inside you. You are also a direct representative of that same thing. Are you listening to me? It means that even in suffering, don't give up on God. God will show up for you in the name of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Because God is not a God that is late. He knows the right time for you. Hallelujah. I said God knows the right time for you. Everything you see working, when you are as a child of God, everything you see working around you, God is working them out all for your good. The Bible says all things work together for good to them that love God and are called according to his purpose. You are not ordinary. So don't equate your circumstance with those of unbelievers. Are you listening to me? Don't equate your situation with those of unbelievers. You are a child of God. There is a divine mandate upon your life. There is a divine message in your circumstance and your situation. Every time you come out of a situation, you have a testimony. And every testimony brings glory to God. Andre Crouch was a singer who sang one of the songs that is probably one of the greatest songs the church has ever sung. Through it all, through it all, I know. See, he was saying that because of the pains he went through, he now knows that God is able. Hallelujah. Because of what he went through, he knew. That made him to know. Hallelujah. You will not understand God to a certain level until you have gone through certain situations. Hallelujah. You will not understand God to a certain level until you go through a particular time of situation, a time that you cannot explain. Job could not explain these times he went through. It was difficult, but he never gave up on God. And because he did not give up on God, look at what happened at the end. Look at what happened at the end. Go to Job chapter 42. First of all, God reprimanded his friends. I declare over someone, God will reprimand your friends in the name of Jesus. Anybody in your life that is not a voice of elevation, God will expose them in the name of Jesus Christ. Any lying tongue in your life, God will silence them in the name of Jesus. Every friend that has no good motive towards you, God shall separate you from them in the name of Jesus. Every relationship you have that is not taking you to your destiny, God shall remove you from them in the name of Jesus. When people leave you sometimes, don't cry over it. Understand that you are not ordinary. That God is working on your behalf. Amen. They say they don't like you. Jesus likes you. Amen. Say amen. Amen. And who matters most? Who is the best friend? Jesus. It is the friend that sticks closer than the brother. And God proved it here. After God had reprimanded his friends and asked an offering. Look at verse 10. God basically asked for restitution from his friends. Do you know that in doctrine, in Christian doctrine, there's what we call restitution? I know that in today's age of grace teaching, many people don't talk about it. But we emphasize doctrine. Don't discard doctrine, because doctrine simply means good home training. Hallelujah. That is what it means. Good home training. Like you come to church, family, we learn the word. It gives you foundation. It means what James called good religion. Hallelujah. Now, the religion, not in the sense of the way the world has corrupted it, but religion in the sense of fear of God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I hope I'm passing the message tonight. Restitution means when somebody took something from you that they are not supposed to take from you. Are you listening to me? God asks restitution of the friends of Job. I declare over you, whatever they have taken from you, they shall return it in the name of Jesus. Anything they have stolen from you, by the hand of God, they shall restitute it back to you in the name of Jesus. You see, what I'm teaching is a concept that is established in scripture, restitution. Even the prophets of old said in Jesus, let me tell you something. It is not allowed. You are the apple of God's eye. You are the anointed of God. Anything that they can't come home and stolen from you, it is your birthright in Christ for it to be restored. That is what restitution means. I am declaring over you tonight, whatever that was stolen from you, whatever the cankerworm has eaten, whatever your friends took from you that belongs to you, that wife that has been stolen from you, that husband that has been stolen from you, they shall be restored in the name of Jesus. And let me tell you something. Let me tell you something. Whenever God is going to restore, he restores sevenfold. Oh, hallelujah. You hear what I'm saying? I said, whenever God is going to restore, he restores sevenfold. Whenever God is going to restore, he gives you double for your trouble. Whenever God is going to give back to you, he gives you double for your trouble. Hallelujah. 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 You know, somebody may say, he will not accept to come back. I'm going to tell you tonight, God will give you better. The Bible says, when one door closes, another one will open. It is God that shuts a door, and it is God that opens a door. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. It is God that said he will make rivers to flow in the desert. God will make water flow for you where there is no water. In the mighty name of Jesus. And Job did not give up on God. And because he did not give up on God, look at what happened. Verse 10, after Job had prayed for his friends, which is what you will do for them that restitute back to you, the Lord made him prosperous again and gave him twice as much as he had before. Somebody say hallelujah.
Hallelujah!
And we read that everything was restored back to him. But listen to this, watch this. It was not only restored back to him, even the people that knew him, they came back and gave even to him. They shall bring to you in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Relationships are vital. That's what I'm teaching you tonight. And they come through the best friend that we have. The best friend is Jesus. The best friend is Jesus. The best friend is Jesus. Hallelujah. Now look at this. There is something very powerful that is here. God not only gave back to Job all the blessing, God also gave him long life. Verse 16, after this, Job lived 140 years. He saw his children and their children to the fourth generation. And so he died old and full of years. Hey, somebody smart. Give Jesus a big hand. Give Jesus a big hand. Oh, hallelujah. I told you God is moving tonight. That is why I sang praises. That is why I worship. God is moving tonight. Are you getting ready? Are you getting ready? This is what happened for the Lord Jesus. And this Jesus, if they knew, the Bible says, if they knew, they would not have crucified the Lord of glory. The same way Job suffered, Jesus suffered. And after Jesus suffered, the Bible says, on the third day, he rose again from the dead. You know, he didn't give up on God. Do you know it was Jesus that said to God on the cross, what did he say? Father, Father, why have thou forsaken me? He didn't forsake God. God did not forsake him. He said it in his humanity. Hallelujah. It was proof of his humanity. He came to understand your pain I said, Jesus understands your pain.
Amen.
Jesus understands your sorrow.
Amen.
Jesus understands your struggle.
Amen.
And because he understands it, he will give you victory.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
He is your best friend.
Yes.
He is the one that sticks closer than a brother.
Yes.
He is not going anywhere. The greatest promise in all the Bible is found in the book of Matthew.
Mm-hmm.
Chapter 28. Let us read that. Matthew chapter 28. Matthew chapter 28. Look at this. The friend that sticks closer than a brother. Look at this. Look at verse 20. Verse 20.
Mm-hmm.
Verse 20b. Jesus was speaking here. The last statement he made according to the Gospel of Matthew. He said, and surely I am with you always to the very end of the age. Somebody say, Jesus is with me always. He is with you in the morning, in the afternoon, in the evening, at all times. That is the greatest promise. That is why you shouldn't fear. Because Jesus, right now, at all times, is always and will always be with you. He proved it with Job. He will prove it with you in the name of Jesus. I said he proved it with Job. He will prove it with you in the name of Jesus. Look at these scriptures. John chapter 15 from verse 14. Let us just look at that to see for you to see that this Jesus will never leave you. He will never forsake you. Hallelujah.
Yeah, yeah.
He said he will be with you at all times. John chapter 15. Look at what Jesus said. I am presenting this best friend for you in a picture. That it will take probably the whole world to help you misunderstand it.
Mm-hmm.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Look at John chapter 15, verse 14. He says, you are my friends. Hallelujah. You are my friends if you do what I command. Look at verse 15. I no longer call you servants because a servant does not know his master's business. Instead, I have called you friends. For everything that I learned from my father, I have made known to you. Hallelujah. You did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you to go and bear fruit. Fruit that will last. Then the Father will give you whatever you ask in my name. And his commandment to us before he left was love each other. Hallelujah. Now look at this other scripture. 2 Corinthians chapter 5 verse 21. 2 Corinthians chapter 5 verse 21. 2 Corinthians chapter 5 verse 21. It says, verse 21 says, and God made him who had no sin to be what? Sin for us. But that means sin offering. Let me give you a picture of what Jesus did for us. In the Old Testament, they bring an animal, and according to the law of Moses, they transfer their aggressions. The priest will make oblations, transfer the aggressions on the animal. Praise the Lord. Are you following me? Just imagine now you bring a ram or a goat. Okay? Imagine, just watch me now. You bring a ram or a goat. And they transfer, you take all of your iniquities, all of your sin, and you pass it on the head of the animal. And the animal is sacrificed. You get what I'm saying? The animal is what? Sacrificed. So the animal is an offering of sin. Jesus, with his body that he made, that became flesh and blood, so that he can understand your pain, also has become that offering once and for all. It means, do your head like this. Carry all the trouble. Carry all the sickness. Are you listening to me? Somebody take it on. Carry it on. Carry it on. Carry it on. Put it on Jesus. Are you following me now? Jesus became your what? Sin offering. Oh, somebody say amen.
Amen.
He became the cause for you so that there will be no cause on you according to the book of Galatians. God made him who had no sin to be sin for us so that in him we might become what? The righteousness of God. Praise the Lord. Look at 2 Corinthians chapter 8 from verse 9. Look at 2 Corinthians chapter 8 from verse 9. 2 Corinthians chapter 8 verse 9. For you know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, yet for your sakes he became poor, so that through his poverty you might become
rich.
Somebody say, I will be rich in Jesus' name.
I will be rich in Jesus'
name. Somebody say,
I
am rich in Jesus' name. Because Jesus made me rich. Because Jesus became poor so that I will be rich. Oh, what a best friend. Hallelujah. What a friend we have in Jesus. What a friend we have in Jesus. Hallelujah. You know that hymn. Praise the Lord. Jesus is the best friend any of you can have. Hallelujah. And because of time, because I want us to start praying, I'll have given you more scriptures, but I want you to know this. God will never forsake you.
Amen.
If you look at Psalms chapter 34, you will see that affliction is a reality of life. Hallelujah. Psalms chapter 34, let us look at verse 19 to 20. Psalms chapter 34, look at verse 19 to 20. It says, a righteous man may have many troubles, but the Lord delivers him from them all. He protects all his bones. Not one of them will be broken. Do you know that I was speaking of Jesus, your best friend? That the same thing, because it happened to him, it will also what happen for you. Your bones shall not be broken in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
You know that when the Romans, when they crucified people who committed crime or whatever, after they crucified them, after the people, they will come after to check them whether they are still dead or whether they are alive. Are you listening? Often the people are still alive. They are unconscious already, but there's still life in them. Are you listening? So often the Roman soldiers will break the bones to initiate the death. Okay? But when they came to Jesus, after they brought him down, he had already, remember, on the cross, it had to be on the cross. There are many significant truths for Jesus dying on the cross. I was telling you some weeks ago when I was teaching, I was telling you about the type of Jesus. When God told Moses, put the snake on the stick, that when they look at it, on the pole, when they look at it, the snake bites, they will get healed. That was a picture of Jesus on the cross. That is why the Hebrew writer told us in Hebrews chapter 12, verse 2, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. Are you following me? So he had to die on that cross. He had to give up the ghost. Remember, he gave it by himself. That is that same offering he had become. Hallelujah. And so Jesus, when they came to him, they found that he had already what? Gone. He had already, you know, he said on the cross, into the hand I commend my spirit. And the Bible says he gave up the ghost. So when they came to him, he was already gone. He was not, his body was already, he was physically dead. Hallelujah. And they didn't break his bones. That is a confirmation. That is a fulfillment of this verse. Hallelujah. David, by the Spirit of God, was prophesying ahead of time of what will happen to the Christ. Hallelujah. And I prophesy over you. God cannot lie. Because God cannot lie, if the bones of Jesus was not broken, your bones will not be broken in the name of Jesus. So it doesn't matter what you are going through. It doesn't matter the circumstances of life. I am telling you tonight, there is a certainty. There is a guaranteed outcome. That outcome is that the end is better than the beginning.
Amen.
Hallelujah. You shall end well in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
That is what God is saying. It will go well for you in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Nothing will happen to you. Do you know I have told people this spiritual revelation? And they're like, oh, didn't see that. That even those people that believers that die in air accident, in air crash, or in car accident, that their bodies, you didn't find them, you didn't see them. On the day Jesus will come back, all those things will come back together, just like it was in the days of Ezekiel. The Bible says that the dry bones came together. Because none of the bones shall be broken. Are you listening to me? It is a promise of God. So no matter what the enemy puts on you, it shall not hurt you in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Do you know that you can go through pain, but God said it will not hurt you? So you should not allow pain to hurt you. That is why Jesus Christ says they shall by no means hurt you. You will take up, nothing will hurt you. In the book of Psalms chapter 91, it says the same thing. They shall not come near your dwelling place. Things, there can be circumstances that goes around you. You'll be like, oh, put your hope in God. Look to Jesus. Think of Job. If Job could make it, I will make it. Are you hearing me? Because God has it under control. Because my best friend is with me. That best friend doesn't change. He doesn't change. The Bible says he is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Hebrews chapter 13, verse 8. He is not changing because of the weather. He is not changing because of your mood. God is not in a bad mood. It doesn't matter what you think. I said God will never leave you nor forsake you in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
He will come through for you in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
I said he will come through for you in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
And tonight we shall maximize that godly relationship in Christ. Are you listening to me? The Bible says in Romans chapter 10 verse 13. God bless you, my dear. Look at that. Romans chapter 10 verse 13. Look at what he said. Our best friend told us to. Romans chapter 10. He said, for everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. Everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. Tonight we are going to maximize that partnership with Jesus, our best friend. We are going to call on his name. Hallelujah. And when we call on his name, we will receive from him. Hallelujah. Go with me to the book of Matthew chapter 18. Go with me to the book of Matthew chapter 18. Praise the Lord. Look at what Jesus, our best friend, told us. This is Jesus speaking to us now from verse 18 and to 20. Jesus, our best friend, said, I tell you the truth. Whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven. And whatever you lose on earth will be loosed in verse 19. Again, I tell you that if two of you on earth agree about anything you ask for, it will be done for you by my Father in heaven. For where two or three come together, where two or three are gathered in my name, there I am in the midst of them. Somebody say hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Go to Matthew chapter 7 verse 11. Matthew chapter 7 verse 11. God speaking here. Jesus, this is our best friend telling us. He said, if you then, though you are evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your Father in heaven give good gifts to those who ask him? Somebody stand on your feet. Begin to give God glory. Begin to give God glory. Oh, somebody say, this is my best friend. Thank you, Jesus, for this relationship. Thank you, Jesus, for this friendship. Somebody begin to give. Oh, tonight we're going to maximize this friendship. We're going to maximize this relationship. We're going to take our portion in him. We're going to receive the best of God for us. Oh, somebody give him glory. Somebody say, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus, for saving me. Thank you, Jesus, for saving my soul. Thank you. Somebody begin to pray. Somebody begin to pray. Lord, I give you glory. Thank you for those of you that are joining us live tonight. You are here for miracles tonight. Just give him glory. Say, thank you, Father, for your word that came forth. Thank you, Father, for your word that came forth. Thank you, Father, for this time of ministry. Thank you, Father, for my best friend, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus, that you came, that you died for me, that you rose again on the third day. Thank you, Jesus, that you became my sin offering. Somebody pray, somebody pray. Thank you, Jesus, that you are my propitiation. Thank you, Jesus, that you are the mediator between me and God. Thank you, Jesus, that because you live, I can face tomorrow. Somebody give God glory. Somebody give God glory. Somebody say, thank you for my friendship with Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. You are the fairest of 10,000. You are my amen. You are my faithful witness. Oh, you are my sure foundation. Oh, you are the rock on which I stand. Somebody pray, somebody pray. Somebody pray, somebody pray. This is a special night of miracles. We are taking advantage of that relationship with our Jesus. We are taking advantage of that special relationship. Oh, somebody pray. It is a special relationship. It is a special relationship. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus, that I have you. Thank you, Jesus, that I know you. Faithful is he that calleth you, who also will do it. Oh, hallelujah. Be confident of this very thing that he that called, he will also do it. He that called me will also do it. Oh, he will perfect everything that concerns me. In him we live and move and have our being. Oh, Kababashanda, somebody pray. Say, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus, for my special relationship with you. Thank you, Jesus, that you hear me. Thank you, Jesus, that you hear me. Thank you for your word. Thank you for your word that I heard tonight. Let it walk and speak in my life. Let it create avenues of blessings for me tonight. Oh, somebody receive this special blessing. Somebody receive. Say, thank you, Jesus. 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 Thank you that I'm here tonight. Because I came, I will be blessed. 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 Somebody pray that prayer of thanksgiving. I want to give you time to pray that prayer of thanksgiving before we proceed into other prayer points. We are going to be praying all manner of prayers tonight. Say, Father, thank you for this special relationship I have with Jesus. Thank you for my best friend, Jesus. Thank you because you brought me through. Thank you because you brought Joe through. Because you brought him through, you will bring me through. Thank you, Jesus, that you are my best friend. Thank you, Jesus, for this godly relationship I have with the Lord. Thank you, Father. Thank you because my names are written in the book of life. Thank you, Lord, because my name, my surname, my first name, and my last name, they are written in the book of life. Thank you because my middle name is written in the book of life. Thank you because my my children's name is written in the book of life. Thank you because, Father, I am a partaker of the kingdom of God. Thank you because I am saved. Thank you for the blood that speaks for me. Oh, somebody say, thank you, Jesus. Let me hear prayers going up. 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 Oh, Baba Bashanda. Oh, hey, hey, hey. Oh, oh, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord, because I know you. Thank you, Lord, because you love me, Father, you love you. Thank you, Lord, because you came and you died for me. Thank you, Father, who is the creator of all flesh. Thank you, Father, of spirit. Thank you, Lord, because we have come to the garden of judgment here in heaven. Oh, thank you, Jesus. You that is online, join me praying. Say thank you, Jesus. Say thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Elohim. Thank you, Alpha and Omega. Thank you, Lord, because I am here tonight. Thank you, Lord, because I am partaking tonight. Thank you, Lord, for your move tonight. Thank you, Lord, for your flow tonight. Thank you, Lord, for rivers of living water. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for rivers of living water. Oh, Kababashanda. Hey, hey, ho, ho, si. Kolibre, sekenta, eh. Lesu, si, dike, hez. Oh, ha, ha. Takaba. Oh, thank you, Jesus. In the mighty name of Jesus. In the mighty name of Jesus.